The Blue, Miss Jennifer Batten. Ja. I just told them the story that we met in my living room a couple of years ago, and you were bugging me for this little...
Yeah, I didn't even know that he made amps. I only knew him as a guitar player. And I had seen you at a couple trade shows, killing it, sounding amazing. Plus, he was friendly. That's always a bonus. Yeah,
that helps a tiny little bit. Yeah. She was actually my first customer. She saw the amp, and you wanted one.
You plugged me in, and I said, when? Here's my wallet. When can I have it? And he made me wait and wait and wait.
Prototype, prototype, prototype. So I think it took half a year or a few months, and then I could send you the first unit.
Yeah, yeah, I was drooling. There was, you know, all over my chin. I was so excited that he came up with something else, and so I'm always... Come on, come on. I need to try one prototype.
Yeah.
And I liked it so much that that's all I used to record. I had at least 6 microphones. I gave them away. Because the whole thing of miking your speaker that's in another room, you got to get up, go change it by a micrometer and then come and listen to it, and then that sucks, and you keep going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth until you're so bored you just don't want to record anymore.
Yeah. You know? And that's the worst, because when it comes to music, you have to have the energy.
Yes.
And
the inspiration.
Yeah. The workflow needs to be happening. Otherwise, you know, it's not fun. And this is why I did the BluBox as simple as could be. You know, if you are the engineer guy, type of guy that spends 2 hours, you know, doing the setup, hey, you can use some IRs out there and you can work on it. But that same day, I doubt that you do a recording. But,
right, yeah.
You know, but if you use like the BluBox, I wanted something super simple that works in a live situation too. Because in live situations, okay, for me, I was always very, very curious about how do I sound out there. Because wearing in-ears, I guess you had to do that too.
Oh, I've worn in-ears many times. 3 years with Jeff Beck and your ears will never be the same. That shit was loud. So, yes, I have.
Yeah, we were just stopping at the traffic light and she said, you know, Jeff Beck would have still made it. I had to use in-ears too, and I found how sensitive the whole signal path is. If your in-ears is like a hi-fi speaker and there's no air in between, so you have to make sure you have the right frequencies that gives you something that feels like guitar. And back in the days, I used microphones in front of speakers, but the sound was not consistent because the microphone was always moved a little bit, and I ended up taking the mics apart, putting the capsule behind the front grill, but in front of the speaker, so they were fixed.
And of course you did.
Yeah, and this was what I was using at the tic-tac-toe tour. And I even brought my own tube mic preamp to make sure that the sounds are well balanced, to give it to the audio guy and say, okay, use the signal, keep it flat. Hmm. And the good thing about this direct solution is when you play a festival, you know the signal sounds good. Once you have a good sound, the guy says, oh, it's already there, done.
Yeah.
So this was my trick, always to deliver a good sound straight into recording or, you know, in a live situation.
I think every guitar player just dreams of having the ultimate control.
Yeah.
I mean, you have a guitar you like, you have an amp you like, and to know that the signal is consistent that's going out. Every time I would finish a tour, I would think of more ways that I could get control. I have control issues.
Well,
that's what
me
it
too.
Is.
But why?
Because there's always going to be variables in every venue that you play anyway. You know, even this venue with no people in it sounds different than when it's full. So
right.
If you can control your sound, that's all you can do.
Right. Okay, what about your setup? So you have... there's many ways how you can use the AMP1, but maybe you can explain your setup.
Yeah, I'm using the four cable method. So I have this Digitech RP1000, which they have stopped making, which means they're really cheap on eBay.
Yeah, but they still sound killer.
Yeah, there are sounds in here I cannot find in any other unit. So
what is the four cable method?
When you have a four cable method, then you can choose which effects are before the preamp and which effects are between the preamp and the power amp. So I have done that. And let me go through a few sounds that I like, because I like to use a lot of sounds. I do a multimedia show film, and I like just to entertain my own ears, I like to have a variety of sounds and effects. So I use a bunch of them, and I'll just go through. First, the solo sound with some... Then I have the exact same thing with no delay, little reverb for rhythm. I have banks of 10, so in each bank, I have several things that are the same in every bank, like the solo sound, but I have different specialty effects.
Yeah.
And then there's the yaw. It's like a talk box that's a lot more sanitary. let's see, envelope filter. Got my favorite clean sound. Whammy pedal a lot to take the chord or tone down in a whole step. Sometimes I'll use a whammy pedal to going up. I have a song called Cat Fight. What the hell happened there? It's you. I thought my cat got loose. Let's see. A lot of tap dancing. A little tremolo. A ring modulator with my foot there. One thing I really want to say, having the AMP1 has improved my sound so much, but in one way, the level is consistent. If anybody's worked with digital modeling kind of things, you go from one sound to the next and you're always chasing the volume, and all of a sudden that problem was gone, which is worth a hell of a lot.
Yeah, an amp really gives you like a frequency foundation that kind of, you know, all the programs that you do on the digital side have to go through one amp sound, or, you know, at least, and an amp is also has a compressing element. So it's like a filter. So in the frequency spectrum, your sounds will be placed at a very real, you know, amp, because it's an amp. It really plays it somewhere. And it's not just an EQ, you know? And the other element is compression. And EQ and compression, this is what it's all about. Mm. So, and this is what a speaker does and what an amp does. So if you have a real speaker and a real amp, you're not jumping in volume that much anymore, unless you do super dramatic stuff. But if you have a straight into the PA digital device, it's so sensitive. Every dB that you change is like too much or too much treble, and you're never sure. Yeah. You know, so this kind of is a blends it. In German, das bindet ab. Whatever this means in English. It's like when you cook, you know, cooking. Yeah, it's like a process that melts the effects with a basic foundation. And that was every amp does, and the AMP1 does for you.
And also, when I added this to my system, I've done a lot of clinics around the world for Digitech, so I got into using the amp models. And one thing you cannot do successfully with that is to roll back the volume and clean it up. It just turns to poop.
Yeah, but this roll back the volume is all I'm doing. So this is for me, if I will ever do an amp that does not do that, you know,
I'll shoot you.
Yeah, you can shoot me. This is official. Because, you know, my heroes back in the days were the British guitar players, mainly. I mean, of course, Jeff Beck, but also Richie Blackmore. And, I mean, he had, or Brian May and, you know, Rory Gallagher, a lot of Strat players. And they all had a little trick. They had the so-called Rangemaster Treble Booster. And this is the original device,
wow.
Worth shits load of money. And it's only one transistor.
Wow.
So, and the thing in here is it cuts down the bass and it enhances the middle and the treble. And they use this to make the overdrive sound. And this cleans up like crazy.
Wow.
And once you play this thing, you don't want to miss that. And this is it for me. And so everything I do has this influence on it.
He built that in his last life.
Last century. Yeah, anyway. Pass auf. Okay, the question was, why didn't I build this into my amp? Because I wanted to have my amp as an amp and have the effects as effects. So there is no tuner in my amp and there's no Rangemaster in my amp. But my amp with the Rangemaster, spot on. If not, kill me. I could prove. You wanna hear this?
Of course we do.
Okay, you go on and explain a little bit about your setup. In the meantime, I do a setup with this.
Okay. It's not much more than I just told you, except that I always add a volume pedal, because even if I'm playing to tracks, it's really hard to get every bit of every track the same level. So if I need to boost a little bit, I don't have to run back to the amp to, you know, boost it up, and then I have to boost it back down. It's always at my foot. And especially when you're playing with a band, the volume can go all over the place. If the drummer gets real excited, you either got a volume pedal or you're gonna get lost. And I spent a lot of years getting lost. So I add that. And I add a Boss V50 only because it's plastic and lightweight. And even coming over for a week, the airlines kicked my butt for being 1 pound overweight. Oh, great. Now I'm carrying that pound into my seat. We're so much safer now. You know, it's grueling. Airlines get worse and worse. So I basically use the classic 2 pound for all my lead stuff, all my crunch stuff. And then I toggle back and forth to the clean sound as I need it. And if Digitech had been smart enough to keep MIDI in their system, I wouldn't even have to step on the amp at all. It would just be automatic in whatever clean patch I chose. So that's it. I throw it in my suitcase. And I'm actually looking at the Line 6 has a brand new effects unit. It's the effects part of their Helix. And I haven't even started programming that, but I was interested in it because it's 5 pounds less. That's the only reason. Yeah. And they don't have a talker in it, so I'm sad about that, and I'm buying every possible talker pedal to see what could be a substitute.
Yeah, talker. So I show you now this Rangemaster
Great.
Thing. Okay. I use this amp here, which is, as you can see, straight connected to the cabinet. And the other side is my guitar inputs, one cable. So that's my clean channel, okay? I put the guitar on full and I play a little bit. Well, clean channel, a little dirty. So now I use this Rangemaster. I hope it works. It does. Okay, das Noise ist natürlich ist genauso vintage, aber das war mein clean, this was my clean channel boosted with this unit. And there is no overdrive in it. It's just a booster. So the whole drive, the whole saturation comes from my amp. But the way, you know, and it cleans up like this is, yeah, or even if you play clean Queen tunes, you know, like We Are the Champions, you know, you can hear this pedal. This is. Oh, wow. I show you. Okay, very old school, but this is how, you know, physically I'm impressed by sound, and it starts with a clean tone and with the right kind of overdrive. It's not about making as much gain as possible and get a muddy something, but it starts here. Everything I do is kind of starting from this point. Okay, this was the Rangemaster, and by the way, there are nice and pleasant copies that are not so noisy, but funny, the old one sounds still best.
I think we're all pretty lucky that a guy like that, I call him the Einstein of sound when I'm talking about him. Yeah.
Okay, I have another experiment for us. I give you my beloved Marshall. We heat it up. And I plug in...
I'm not going to put on a blindfold. It's going to mess up my hair. I'll just look away.
Yeah.
First things first.
Let me see what's... I need the speaker cable as well. Okay. What amp are you hearing? Is this my beloved Plexi, which is a real Plexi? We are talking the real deal with the real Mahler tubes from the late 60s, mint condition, or is this the AMP1? Okay, I make a few noises. That's the Marshall.
Würde ich sagen. Einfach so aus Blau, weil die sind
sehr. It's not the Marshall. Okie doke. So, any more questions? What about, I want to know a few things that she does on playing. I mean, the first thing is you are famous for your tapping. I always had big trouble with the tapping. What is the secret to make a clean tapping?
I don't know. I guess having an amp one and a clean channel. Is that the right answer?
No, is the angle of the fingertips important, stuff like that?
Yeah, well, always it's important not to ever feel tension in your hand. You know, if you're turning it too much, like I see classical people doing that, I just go, oh boy, you're going to have trouble in your later years. It's just got to be very, very easy, like you're shaking hands with the board. And this is something when I'm teaching students, they always have their thumb out and they're having trouble finding it. And I go, put your thumb down. It really helps to have the thumb gliding along.
A guide. It's a guide.
Yeah.
Super.
When I first started tapping live, I'd be doing the bend and come from outer space into the middle.
To the wrong place, like me.
To silence.
Yeah.
Looks good, but not very impressive.
Yeah, I see.
Just a very light touch. I have, I've gone to very light strings, 8 to 42.
Wow, okay.
Because my hand, okay. I got sissy hands.
But you need some stamping seat.
It keeps the open strings quiet.
Yeah.
With a clean sound, it's not that important. But when you have distortion, I'll do the before and after. Some people prefer that last one, but not me.
Yeah. But this is a general thing, you know. Also, when she plays and when she's not playing, the volume's always closed.
Yeah.
So Jennifer played many years with Jeff Beck, which is one of my heroes, and nobody plays like Jeff Beck. But maybe you've been so close, and you can tell us a few things that you could see. Like sneaking around the corner, you know, maybe he bites his nails before he plays, or what, you know, is he doing anything that we should...
I could tell you a few things. When I joined him, he changed something on stage, which was to... usually people have monitors blasting at them, and if you actually own the stage, you're the headliner, you got side fills, so it's generally nice big stages. But he started also slaving Celestians off his Marshall so they'd be facing him as well as hitting them in the butt. So it was like surround sound Beck, which was the most hi-fi thing, just glorious.
And I imagine very loud.
Yeah. I mean, if it was just him playing loud, it would be fine. But then you had the drummer.
to step up with him, yeah.
Yeah, it was bashing. Yeah.
Who was the drummer back in the day?
The first drummer was Steve Alexander.
Ah, I know.
And then,
I met him at some class teaching kind of thing.
Okay.
Nice guy with curly hair, dark hair. Yeah.
Welch.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
And then Andy Gangadine did the last tour. Andy, he played with the Spice Girls.
Ah, okay.
He would probably kick me for saying that because he is so much more.
Sure.
And then Randy Hope Taylor played bass on all the tours.
Cool.
Yeah. Go ahead.
He does some mysterious bendings, I think. And
yeah, he's a freak.
Is there anything that you discovered for yourself? I mean, for me, he's such a holy figure. Yeah. I don't even dare to play to his records. I've never copied something of him. I mean, when I was younger, I was not afraid. I put on some CD and I was noodling around along, and then I gave a shit. Okay, but... You know, when I started to listen to Jeff Beck, I was like, oh, now it's silence because I listen, you know. And when I listen, I cannot play anymore. I don't know how to play Jeff Beck because I only listen to Jeff Beck.
Well, like a lot of people, at least 90% of it is in the DNA. It's in the hands, the feel, that, you know, guitar players, there's 1,000 different nuances that you don't even realize you're doing to create your sound. Whether it's your vibrato or the way you slide is a little different from everybody else. I will say that I spent a lot of time going to rehearsal early to play his Strat through his Marshall, and it never came close.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
He's got a very, very strange setup. His bridge, I mean, usually is parallel to the board. It was angled. He uses the tremolo bar a lot. I don't know if he has perfect pitch, but he has perfect relative pitch, so that if he goes out of tune, he will bend it in tune. And if anybody knows the ballad, Where Were You, he plays the melody in harmonics with the bar, and he's right on the money. Then there's another one called Angel Footsteps, where I didn't realize what he was doing for the longest time because he'd be in the front and I'd be behind him and I'd see the back of his guitar neck. And then one day I saw him and he's got a slide in his right hand playing notes way beyond the fretboard. And when you do that, just a micro movement is going to be a different note. Mm. So your ears have to be good for that. Yeah, he's from outer space, definitely. Other than that, it's pretty much a stock Strat and a Marshall.
Sure.
One more thing, that he really doesn't want anything between his guitar and the amp. He'll have a wah-wah. For the song Blue Wind, it starts with a flanger. His tech would actually kick in the flanger that was back behind the speakers, and it was completely out of the chain for the rest of the show. For even delay and reverb, he did not have that. It had to be provided by the mixing engineer. So that was part of rehearsals, is going through each song, this is the delay I want, this is the reverb. So it was a completely clean signal.
Wow. Okay, any more questions or music? Music, okay.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Blug, Jennifer Batten.